You refer to the prophecy of the one who will bring balance to the Force.
You believe it's this boy?
He can see things before they happen.
He can help you.
The Force is unusually strong with him.
He was meant to help you.
Anakin! Tell him to take off!
Will I ever see you again?
What does your heart tell you?
Are you sure about this? Trusting our fate to a boy we hardly know?
Anakin Skywalker, meet Obi-Wan Kenobi.
I sense much fear in you.
The boy is dangerous. They all sense it. Why can't you?
Fear is the path to the dark side. Fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate. Hate leads to suffering.
All right, so over the last couple of weeks, we've talked about making the best out of a, you know, bad situation and really just, you know, trying to make, you know, the best of it. What better way to do that than to watch Star Wars? That is the best way. This is The Wars and More. I'm Joe, and of course with me is my good buddy Doug. Hey Doug, how you doing this week?
Doing pretty good. It's always a good time watching Star Wars.
Yes, yes. And that's exactly what we're going to do. We've been wanting to do our film commentaries for a while. We did one. We did A New Hope.
Yes.
But we really wanted to get back into them, and just scheduling is a nightmare when you try to set aside a couple hours to watch a film and talk about it, you know?
Yeah, totally. With, I don't know, everyone knows how it is, you know, busy with families and, you know, different things going on, so.
Yeah, between work and.
Oh, yeah.
Everything else, it's hard to get time to, and you know, we still do our weekly show. We didn't want to like skip a weekly show to do it.
Yeah.
So we got downtime. Might as well make the best of it.
That's right.
And instead of continuing with where we went, we wanted to start fresh with The Rise of Skywalker out. The saga's complete.
Yep.
We've got a whole new outlook on everything. So we wanted to start from the beginning of the story.
Yes.
With episode one, The Phantom Menace.
Which will be nice because we have the context of the whole saga now. So.
Yep.
That'd be cool.
All right. So we are watching the Disney Plus version. You're watching Disney Plus version, right, Doug?
Yep.
So. We're going to watch the Disney Plus version. How this is going to work, we got it set to zero. We got it all started up. Timer's at zero. Doug will give us a countdown. 3, 2, 1, go. And we hit play on go. Makes sense, Doug?
Makes sense. You ready?
Yeah, let's get at it.
All right. 3, 2, 1. One, go.
I am amazed that they did leave the 20th Century Fox fanfare in for the Disney Plus releases.
Yeah, I like it, I gotta say. You know, it's one of those things that it's so familiar to me still.
Yeah. So this is a special film for me because this is the first Star Wars film that I got to see in theaters.
Right.
For its original release.
Yes. This, you know, we've had a lot of contention with, you know, episode 8 and all that kind of stuff. It seems like everyone's forgotten all about all the stuff that went on with this one.
Right. And I did crack up at that first line, too. You know, turmoil has engulfed the Galactic Republic. It's like, well, we haven't seen the Galactic Republic yet.
Exactly.
And it's already screwed up.
Yeah, I know. The thing is, you know, and I guess just from the crawl here, we don't have the context of how long the Republic's been in place and stuff. So we don't know. But I mean, it is, you know, called Star Wars, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it would be even weirder if it started with, like, all is good.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So, yeah. I remember the trailer for this film and how awesome that was, you know. They did the same kind of thing for The Rise of Skywalker, you know, that every saga has a beginning, but
yeah.
So
for me, right off the bat, we're getting like kind of a different look at things here.
Well, yeah, you're not starting in the middle of a conflict.
Yeah. And, you know, seeing different ships and then these droids, that was kind of strange, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, start with a droid army.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's you really start with a lot of questions because you really don't have any context for anything that's going on right now.
Exactly. You know,
And now looking at it, you kind of want to get more stories before this.
Oh, sure. Sure.
That was one of my favorite things about the Plagueis novel, is it kind of gave you Palpatine's story up to this point.
Yes. Yes, and then it plays right alongside the movie for a little bit. It's kind of cool.
I thought this mindset about the Jedi, you know, like, we're dead. This isn't good. This is really bad. I thought the Jedi were the good guys, you know?
Yeah.
You know, and they're talking about, well, we're not doing anything wrong. Oh, crap, there's Jedi. I guess we are doing something wrong.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. You can justify it all the way up to a point, I guess, right? And then when you got to, like, really explain yourself, well, that's when you're just trying to kill him.
Then we see Sidious so early.
Oh, yeah.
It's a character that they really held back from us in the original trilogy, but right away in this film.
Oh, yeah. Did you ever have a problem differentiating Sidious from Palpatine, Senator, and then Chancellor?
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, I guess I had the benefit of, you know, the original trilogy under my belt, but it's like a lot of people, I guess, didn't really realize it was the same person.
Well, I mean, I really had the original trilogy under my belt before this. This was just my first theatrical Star Wars.
Yeah. I know.
No, I didn't really have a problem with that. It was, you know, pretty well known to me at that point that, you know, Palpatine was Palpatine. I can't remember where I got that information.
Okay.
Because they never used that name Palpatine in the original trilogy.
Correct.
So I can't remember where I got that information, but I knew.
I believe, if I remember correctly, the action figure for Palpatine was a mail-in, and you had to send in for it, and for Emperor Palpatine. I'm not sure if that was the first place that I saw it, but I'm pretty sure that's how that went.
Right. So this always blew my mind. So why is the blast door like melting away? But you know, the door that he on his side is, you know, just got this little hole.
Yeah. Well, you know, lightsaber physics.
Yeah, it's the Force, man. He's probably using the Force to push that heat.
Yeah. The one thing that was really cool about this was, you know, you're a few minutes into this movie and it is action.
Yes.
Lightsaber action, which is kind of awesome.
And when they took off right there, when I saw that the first time, I was like,
oh, yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah, I know it.
The speed?
Yes.
So we knew right away we were going to see Jedi ability that we had never seen.
Absolutely.
There's that Star Wars humor. What did you think of the costumes for Nuke Gunray? First reaction.
I don't know. It seemed kind of Star Wars-y to me. I don't know. Why do you ask?
Well, I just know there was a lot of complaints about costumes like that, given all the CG work, and then you have these, you know, more practical costumes.
So for me, I guess I kind of appreciated that, you know, they still did a lot of the practical effects alongside the CG work. I don't really mind it.
Right.
I mean, when I'm going to see a movie like this, you know, suspension of disbelief is forefront for me. I don't think it's a problem. I just like to lose myself in this world.
That was a good tip off too, right there, that Palpatine was Sidious. You know, as his voice breaks up right there, it's kind of like, huh. Kind of sounds like the bad guy we just heard.
Yeah.
Waiting for the ambassadors. Then the communications go out. One guy says it can only mean invasion. Everybody's like, they wouldn't dare. Yeah, the writing's on the wall.
Yeah.
Their communications went out, but apparently they don't have any, like, real military capabilities to, you know, say, hey, a whole army just entered our atmosphere.
Well, that's one thing about Naboo. Well, I mean, you should be able to tell this, but, you know, clearly their ships and all that kind of stuff, it's primarily for a local defense. You know, they have long range capabilities and all, but you know, they're starter fighters. In the end of this, you know, they're not really designed for long range use.
Oh, here's everyone's favorite character.
Absolutely.
What an introduction.
Yes.
Oh, boy, boy. Another another species that the life debt is a thing.
Yeah. It's one thing that I always loved about Star Wars is the combination of like ancient ways of doing things along with futuristic technologies and stuff. It's, you know, it's part of what makes it so awesome. You know, the idea of a life debt, it's, you know, you think of it as kind of like an old way of doing things.
Yeah. And I always thought it was so interesting that it seems like every place that has like a very luxurious lifestyle, there's also a group of natives.
Yes.
That are very, you know, what's the word?
Kind of
like tribal, very,
yeah, yeah,
you know, old way.
Yeah.
Like every planet we go to.
Yeah.
Although they're, there's a word for what I'm wanting to say. It's just not coming to me. You know, like their lack of technology.
Yeah.
But it's an interesting lack of technology because they have different kinds of technology.
Exactly.
Very crude type technology.
Yeah.
But, you know, we're only like 15 minutes into the movie and we've already seen so many different, you know, landscapes and sceneries and,
oh yeah,
couple different action sequences already. They didn't come at us slow.
Oh no. Well, that was good on George's part here. I think he knew what he was doing.
Yeah.
I mean, just looking at this scene here, this is like so grand, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Star Wars gets the word doo-doo.
Of course.
Ain't nothing wrong with it.
No.
So the indigenous don't like their advanced counterparts.
Exactly. That's, yeah, it's a classic story, right? We're gonna in the middle of all this galactic turmoil, we're gonna take these what do you call it? these two different species inhabiting this planet and bring them together to fight a common enemy kind of thing.
Yeah, and it was I don't know how it is in the current canon, but I know in the old expanded universe they talked about how the Naboo weren't even indigenous to Naboo.
Ah, yeah.
Like they came there from somewhere else.
It you know, kind of makes sense, you know, because they're human, and you know what do humans do? They kind of like spread out over,
right,
over everywhere, you know.
I like this. He's like, He's like, oh, you're going to need help. On second thought. I always wondered was with that whole cheek shaking thing.
Yeah. I always figured it was a display of anger.
Oh, I like this ship too. Like the first time I saw it, I was like, oh, this is cool.
Oh yeah.
Using like a aquatic species design to make a underwater speeder.
Yeah.
And it wouldn't be Star Wars without big creatures.
Of course. This is the point where I'm always thinking, man, these guys are having some really bad luck. Every time they turn around, there's something going wrong.
I mean, that's kind of the story for our heroes.
Sure.
All through the original trilogy, too.
Yeah, true.
It's like, wow, you just can't catch a break. It's just one thing after another. This is probably a little more fast-paced
in
that regard. Yeah, the underwater Godzilla.
Yes.
You remember, I know this is going to be a little off topic from where the film is right now, but do you remember back in these days when this came out, like, to see trailers and stuff, you had to see them with another film.
Oh, yeah.
They weren't so readily available on the internet. Internet was still, you know, kind of small.
Yeah. It'd take you 3 hours to download a 2-minute trailer. Yeah.
Right. So we had to go see films that we really didn't want to see.
Yes.
And this one really stands out because that was a film I really didn't want to see. I was 14 years old.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going to interrupt that story because this scene right here is one of my favorite.
I knew you were gonna say that because, yes, I know you like this scene.
Just when when he throws his arm up on the chair, he's like, "When you think things are bad, man." Say what you will about Jar Jar Binks, this scene is hilarious.
Yes, it is.
And without Jar Jar there, and you have two calm Jedi just taking this situation in stride, it would lack danger.
Yeah, you're right.
Jar Jar gives you the sense of danger there.
And on the other side of that, with Jar Jar freaking out the way he was, and the Jedi being so calm, it gives you a feeling of what Jedi, like organized Jedi, are like in a, you know, situation full of turmoil. So
right. So I think they know there's an invasion now.
Yeah, I was going to say, this is, you know, there was no resistance put forth here. They just marched in.
But we know Naboo doesn't have a proper army.
True.
And this is the problem for the Republic right now, because the Republic itself doesn't have a proper army.
True.
So the Trade Federation, with their, you know, vast droid army, is really going to have, you know, pretty good footing.
Yeah, they can just waltz in and take control. The first time I saw this, at this point, I did not realize the Queen had a double in place here.
No. I mean, I was kind of suspicious.
There was something. I knew there was something. By the time you get off,
The time you get to Tatooine.
Oh yeah.
And it was mostly, and we'll get to that, her demeanor throughout the whole thing.
Yes.
You said, guys, bomb bad. I assume that's the Gungan badass.
Yeah, of course.
They wouldn't dare.
I know.
That's kind of funny. Yeah, in hindsight, you now know, like, the Queen is sitting there looking at her proxy.
Yes.
Like, better say the right thing.
Yeah, exactly. I think they had it all worked out. You know, her handmaid's, your quote-unquote handmaid's reaction can tell her what to say.
Right. You're under arrest.
That was, yeah, having droids that have to find their words, that was kind of funny to me too.
I mean, we just saw this again recently in the Clone Wars.
Sure, yeah.
You know, I've smashed, you know, hundreds of thousands of you.
Yes, that's exactly right.
Blast him. I just can't hate Jar Jar like most people do.
Oh, no. I did love, you know, seeing R2-D2 there, though. That was really cool. And I thought, at that point, it's like, oh, something's got to happen with R2. Because... And then when you see this go on, it was like, oh, yeah.
Yep.
This is where R2's going to shine.
Yeah, that's a... It's a really weird concept to me that, like, these droids go out and, on the outside to fix these things.
It's a weird concept for sure. But again, my suspension of disbelief is thus that it works for me. I don't know.
Oh yeah, I mean it makes sense.
I mean, because they're,
I mean, what they're doing is necessary.
Yeah, and the droids are always riding shotgun in the starfighters too. The X-wings and whatnot. So,
right.
Yeah, and I go in with that baggage of the OT, right? So, works for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but to this point, we've never seen a droid out.
True.
One Naboo cruiser got past the blockade. I think it was the only cruiser right there.
Yeah. Our first look at Maul.
Yeah. Well, I mean, first look in the film.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. We had the trailer, right? But.
Yeah.
I did like how they are always working the camera angles for Sidious. You never got to see him really good in the face. All intentional. Yeah.
So was that the first time we heard Sith?
It might be. Yeah, in the films,
I'm sure. In the films, I think that was the first
usage
of the word.
Yeah. We're going to Tatooine.
And this is why, a lot of people say you didn't have to go to Tatooine in the sequel trilogy, right?
Yeah.
And agreed, you don't have to. But Tatooine was kind of the focal point of this story all along. And you're identifying it as one story, right?
Yeah.
So Tatooine has probably been the most, central part of this, central planet of the story in the saga to this point.
Sure.
I understand not going back to Hoth, not going back to Endor, not.
Yeah.
Even Yavin. You don't have to go to Yavin. But Tatooine's one of those that you should probably make a trip back.
Well, Rey does.
Yeah, and I was going to say, they did at the end.
Yeah. Yep, this is. I love that little scene there. That gives us something to look for when we're heading into town here.
Right. Yeah, I was suspicious right away.
Yeah.
About this actually being the queen.
Then this is so familiar. I love it.
Now, yeah, this is a different port, right?
This is Mos Espa.
Right.
But, so familiar, meaning, similar town on, on the same planet, so.
Mm-hmm. just screams junk dealer.
Like, yeah, absolutely. Yes. Just, working on cars, I've actually talked to these guys.
Yep. Every junkyard has one of these guys.
Absolutely. And what's it do?
Right. I just
yeah.
You know, one thing I never had the advantage of knowing is how this story develops for someone who gets introduced to Anakin in this way.
As far as...
Like, this is your first exposure to Anakin Skywalker.
Yes.
So we had the original trilogy before this, so we had context. We knew his end point.
Yes, exactly. So that's funny. So the thing about Anakin is he's this cute kid, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you think of Darth Vader, you're thinking, okay, as a kid, this guy must have been like, you know, pulling wings off of Toydarians or something. Right. As I watch Watto. But, you know, just blasting womp rats. But no, that was Luke. I don't know. You know, you get what I'm saying, though?
Yeah, you expect him to be a little troublemaker.
Exactly.
Not so innocent.
Right.
And that's a...
This is cool. This is the first time we see, oh, the Jedi mind trick doesn't always work.
Well, it's not the first time. Didn't work on Jabba.
Well, okay.
But there are more creatures out there that it just don't work.
So, okay, yeah. You want to get down to it then. It's like this Jedi mind trick thing. if you're going with the numbers, it's not such a good trick. It's
right. Yeah, that's the it's always the go-to for, like, you know, you're kind of on a backwoods planet.
Oh yeah,
you have people who are from outside there, like, yeah, they automatically treat us like we don't know nothing.
Yeah.
Yeah. You got the droid. Droid's a value.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't do nothing. Well, apparently Anakin is a little bit of a troublemaker.
Yeah, but, I mean,
Why does he want to squash him? He just stops because he's a slave.
Yeah. I think that's all just, you know, bench racing from their past in the pod races.
Yeah. But, like, we know that Saboba's never been beaten, right? So.
Yeah. Huh?
I can understand him being mad at someone that, you know, he's been beaten by. Maybe he just thinks he's going to beat him one day.
Yeah, it's possible. Again, coincidental, we get this sandstorm coming in.
Yeah, and this sweet little boy just helping people he don't even know.
Exactly. I gotta say, that's not the reaction my mom would have if I brought a group of people that looked like that home.
Yeah. Like,
who's this old guy and this amphibian? And
yeah, you're bringing this crazy looking old dude.
Right.
This wacky alien that...
This kind of took me a little bit by surprise, I got to say. I was not expecting that Anakin was going to be the creator of 3PO.
No. Yeah, didn't really expect that at all. I was cracking up last night. I watched The Rise of Skywalker again.
Uh-huh.
And I was cracking up at the, you know, Babu Frick scene when he wipes 3PO's memory.
Yeah.
And later on, he's like, oh, Babu Frick, he's one of my oldest friends.
Yes.
So... So that's something that they never really answered.
What's that?
Were people really dying on Naboo?
There's a political way to look at that. If there's a blockade, right, they can't get supplies to the planet, which would mean people could die. That's always the way that I took that. I don't necessarily think that it was the droid army just, you know, going off all half-cocked and executing people. I always figured, you know, they couldn't trade, therefore people couldn't get things they needed.
They blow you up.
Yes.
So this is kind of where you're like, you were kind of already seeing kind of the failings of the Republic even early on in the film. You know, I can't understand why the Republic would, you know, let this go. The Republic, you know, the Republic doesn't exist out here.
Oh yeah.
So stuff like slavery is still, you know, going
yes.
on.
Yes.
So if you're building a resistance to the Republic, there are plenty of worlds like this that can, you can rally to your cause.
Absolutely. And if not to your cause, at least keep them indifferent. Because I always got the feeling that Tatooine was kind of like just lawless, you know, not one way or the other.
Right. But any question of the Republic needing help coming up is going to be met with, well, the Republic doesn't care about us. Why should we care about them?
Exactly. And you got your first taste of that with the Republic credits are no good here.
Yeah.
Again, nice coincidence. Race tomorrow.
Yeah.
I mean, it's how storytelling works, but it's funny. This seems like it's got a lot of it.
Yeah, but considering all the bad luck they've had.
Yeah.
It is nice to see a turn in their favor.
Sure.
Because you were saying it's like, wow, they just
bad thing after bad thing.
Yeah, it's always bad. Here's our big bad in the story, or in the saga.
Yeah.
Being referred to as someone who was meant to help.
Yeah. And again, here's me, like, he was meant to help you. I don't understand why she's so willing to let him help. I don't, you know, because I don't think she has a grasp of the Force, you know, necessarily. And I don't know.
So, I think Shmi just knows that Anakin's destined to do something great.
Yeah, I guess so.
And she seems, you know, reluctant to let him help, you know, in her facial expressions and things like that. But,
yeah,
she seems resolved that this is what's meant to happen.
Yeah.
She don't like it, but it's meant to be.
So there, right? I see virtuous Jedi lying. He's acquired a pod in the game of chance. You know, Anakin just said he built it. A couple things in this that make you, you know, kind of question, you know, how Jedi operate a little bit. Because going in this, you might have had a thought of, like, the organized Jedi religion, quote unquote, is you know, to always tell the truth, you know. But, you know, we're going to see later on Qui-Gon not let the dice fall where they may. And,
right.
You know, it's things like that. And it's all to a good end, but it just
helps. But I mean, at the same time with him saying that I acquired a pod in a game of chance, I mean, is he telling the truth from like a certain point of view? Like,
see,
it is.
Yeah.
He did acquire a pod by chance.
Yeah.
Wasn't in a game,
right?
But by chance, he did acquire a pod.
It's I guess it's all in how you look at it. I mean, and this is Qui-Gon. He knows. This is he's feeling her out as far as, like, you know, being able to free Anakin. You see the idea brewing in his brain here.
Whoa.
Yeah.
No father.
Right. Yeah.
But our conversation about Shmi and her being so willing to let him do this stuff, she said right there, you know, he deserves better than a slave's life.
Yeah,
you know,
he's, yeah.
She senses greatness in him.
Yeah. Well,
you have, I mean, to, it is her child. You do expect that, but.
Yeah. And you have to admit, if, you know, there's this Immaculate Conception thing going on, that's going to be her first clue that there's something extra about him.
Right. And the scene coming up, you see something too with her. You know, when this thing actually starts up, so. At the same time, you kind of feel like there's part of her that didn't think he was going to get this thing to run.
Sorry, Jar Jar.
Yeah. Uh-oh. I want to know what R2 said right there.
Yes, exactly. You got no idea.
Don't start that.
I do love how no one is just paying attention to Jar Jar.
But yeah, Shmi's face right here is just, I think, very telling. Like, oh crap. He's going to race.
Ah, yeah.
Maybe part of her was thinking, it's not going to work out. He's not going to end up racing.
Right. She'll agree to it, but then it won't happen anyway, so she doesn't have to worry about it.
Right.
Yeah, I got you.
And then, oh, shit. It's running.
Yeah, who's quite a Qui-Gon think he is? Taking the kid's blood without telling them, getting permission.
Checking your blood for infections. You just got cut.
Yeah.
You know, those infections, they start right away, you know?
And again, another lie.
Yeah. You know, now that you're pointing it out, man, this dude lies a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, that's kind of like that story of the Jedi that we know so far, though, right? They think their way is the right way no matter what. They're kind of arrogant in that way.
Yes. Yes. It, at least viewed by some others, that's how it's viewed, as arrogance. You know, the Jedi would look at it as though, you know, they have a thousand generations worth of knowledge behind them, you know, so.
Yeah, and they are very, very blind to things going on around them. Because here you have a Darksider just landed on the same planet you're on, looking for you. But you have no idea.
I think for so long that they haven't had to worry about the Sith, that they're kind of just like off their radar.
Right.
At least that's the way I always thought of it.
This garage area is pretty cool for anyone who's been around.
Yeah.
Most of the time, this stuff's outside.
Yeah. Yes, this is true.
But it is very similar to like when you go to the track and you go back in the pit area, right?
Yes.
It's just cars lined up on either side, hustling, bustling about. But yep. Like I said, normally it's outside.
Yeah, if you have some sort of shelter, you brought it. So,
yeah, little pop up tents.
Yep,
canopies rather.
Yeah, this is well, what I was talking about. I just
happen to have a chance cube.
Yeah,
not because I have a gambling addiction or nothing.
Smee kind of told us about that. It's all about gambling. And again.
Angry gambler.
Yes.
Now we don't have a chance cube no more because you just left it on the ground.
That's what I thought.
So yeah, that chance cube though, I mean, that's the equivalent of a coin flip because it was just blue and red, just two colors.
Yeah, but what I thought was funny is Watto telling Anakin, you better watch your buddy's betting, yet he's the one who got all angry when he lost. It's kind of funny.
So it's that stuff right there. You remember we had our conversation about our favorite characters and stuff each film.
Yeah, yeah.
And I mentioned Padme for this film.
Yeah.
It's those moments where she really, like, she's the one that's putting the perspective in there that really gambling on this stuff, but really not sure any of this is going to work.
Exactly.
Like, we are being very reckless here.
Well, someone in her position, she'd be... pretty detached from, you know, how life can be for the common person, like a lot of these people are, you know, because she's in a pretty elevated position. She asks for something and just gets it, you know?
Right.
Not used to having
to scrape for it, right?
Scrape for it or take a chance on something. Clearly, Sebulba's a star here.
Yeah. Do you have a Nintendo Switch?
I do not.
Oh. So, I just found out that they released Episode 1 Pod Racer for the Switch.
Oh.
You remember that game?
I do. What was that originally on? 64?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. 3 Stooges moment.
Gotta 3 Stooges. A local boy. So there you get the idea that these racers are coming from all over.
Yeah.
I imagine this is a racing circuit. You know, they probably do races here on Tatooine, race on Malastare.
Yeah. Yeah, you would think it would be the way to go. I mean, the way it works.
You know, probably not like Saboba. Saboba probably races exclusively here.
Well, it is, you know, like with any racing, you know, different levels, you have different, you have local racing, you have regional, nationwide. You know, I can see it working that way.
And then someone like Ben Quadraneros, you know, he's out and about. You know, wasn't there posters of him?
Oh, yeah.
Poor Quadraneros gets a tough go here, though.
Yes, he does.
So that other hut in the background, do you get the idea that that's Gardula?
I'm not sure. I never gave it any thought, really.
Even though we know from the other stories, Jabba and Gardula don't get along.
Yeah.
Kind of rival gangs, you know?
Yeah.
But I almost imagine something like this event, they would probably stomach each other.
Yeah. The queen does not, the queen trust my judgment. I like that.
You assume too much.
Yeah.
Yeah, you assume the queen trusts your judgment. Little do you know.
Oh, I think he knows.
You think so?
I think so. I think he's actually using his position to put her in her place a little bit.
Yeah.
Just because, you know, he knows what needs to be done. So
yeah, and he says stuff like that knowing, like, yeah, go ahead, say it. Go ahead and say you're the queen.
Yeah.
Yeah, you won't.
Exactly.
This here is definitely the highlight of this film.
Really?
The pod race? I love the pod. As much as I love the lightsaber battle between Maul and Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon.
Uh-huh.
I love this pod race scene.
I like it. I like it a lot. I'm not sure that it overshadows the lightsaber battle for me, though.
I don't know. That's tough for me. I still think this is my favorite part of the film. I just love this pod race scene. This whole sequence.
It is good.
I mean, yeah, the lightsaber battle, like, we never saw a lightsaber battle like that before.
Exactly.
But we've seen lightsaber battles.
Sure.
We've never seen anything like this pod race.
No. So, okay, so as someone who likes cars, I'm watching these things, and I'm thinking, man, this is really a dumb way to race. You basically have horse-drawn chariots where the horses are jet engines, and you know they float and they're super fast, and you know racing is dangerous enough in a car. With these things, people are just going to be like splattered all over the place.
I think that's the point.
Yeah,
I think
I guess
it's the level of danger and things like that make it entertaining.
Yeah.
Because you could just race speeders.
Exactly. And, but here, we have, once again, something I mentioned earlier is the old combined with the new. It's like a chariot, but with all this technology. Kind of cool. I love how the sand people are just considered like an obstacle for the race.
And then I liken this to, like, you look at racing and the fastest stuff, right? Like, you have your cars, just regular cars.
Sure.
Then you get into your top fuels and things like that. You look at how they lighten it up. You know, it's basically an engine with a structure for the wheels, man.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
And I liken this to that. You have a driver compartment that's very small. Yes. And then the rest of it's all engine, man. I would assume that these are faster than, like, your regular speeders.
Yeah, yeah. I would imagine they'd have to be.
I mean, it sure looks like they're faster than what you would see normally out of a speeder.
Yeah, totally.
But they are. They're all engine with a, you know, compartment for the driver.
A pod. Yeah.
Yeah.
Here we got some classic NASCAR moves going on. Blocking. Yeah. Yeah.
Never seen that NASCAR.
No.
See, that stuff would be sweet in NASCAR.
Yeah, exactly. Usually when that stuff's happening, it's not a good day.
Yeah, it's not good. Normally it's Elliot Sadler.
Yeah, right.
Man, that dude would get airborne like no one else.
Oh, yeah. So I guess we're seeing there's a reason why Sebola always wins, huh?
Yeah. She's a cheetah.
Yep.
What, bro? There's where your design thing comes in. That's...
And okay. So, this kid keeps his cool during all this. And his mother is watching all this happen. And she just, like, looks away a little bit. As opposed to, like, freaking out,
right?
You know.
Yeah, she didn't get any real panic,
right?
A very quiet panic.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, I guess you got a point. Like. Tusken Raiders are just like, just sitting on the cliff shooting at the racers.
I know. That's what I'm saying. It's just kind of like.
Yeah, I got to say that whatever that is that Sebova bent in the beginning.
Yep.
I mean, that really held on for a while, you know?
It sure did. Yeah. I always loved that look on Anakin's face, like, oh, oops.
Like, ass. Whoa. Sue. But yeah, that his calm is just insane.
Yes.
And mad props to Jake Lloyd as a child actor to be showing all that.
Absolutely.
Did he crash it?
We got our Houtini.
Yeah, I know you love that.
Oh, yeah.
Might as well throw some Jawas in there just for the hell of it.
Absolutely.
And then just more of that calm.
Yeah. Yeah. Bunch of symbols flashing. I don't know what any of them mean.
Right. Put the power out, or put the fire out, reroute power.
I guess you can read that, huh?
No.
I know.
I wasn't saying that's what it said.
I know.
I'm saying that's what he does here, you know? Yeah. I'm assuming that readout said, hey, it's on fire.
Yeah.
Yeah, try doing all that in an actual race, right?
Like, exactly.
Typically, an engine fires, yeah, that's it.
Yeah. Day's over.
But I guess that's kind of like your jet engine reference right there, right? There's ways to handle an engine fire.
It's true.
Even Kister's like, oh no.
Yeah.
Like, oh, that's bad.
That's bad. I love those angles where they pan back and you get a perspective on the size of their pods.
Yeah.
Sebulba's is so much bigger engines.
Which would probably be why Anakin's is faster.
Could be. Oh.
I love that.
Yeah.
Whoa, dude. Yeah, I like how the announcers are. It's the same being, but there's two heads. Like,
yeah. So I understand they're on a dusty planet and all. I love the look on Anakin's face there. Around his eyes are clean. Everything else is dirty. It reminds you of the old racers where they wear goggles and stuff. By the end of the race, that's what they looked like. It was cool. Nice throwback.
Yeah, I mean, any of the open cockpit racers, right?
Yep. Like, yeah, for sure.
It's either, you know, the dirt tracks, you're getting dirt all over your face.
Yep.
And even on the asphalt, you're getting, you know, tire rubber and.
Oh, yeah.
You know, just the engines then were a lot dirtier.
Just one of those nice little touches that George put in that, you know, reference to his background, you know, his racing days.
Wasn't a fair bet. Yeah, no one wants to go to the huts.
Yeah. That's that just shows you right there if you know, if you're ever wondering, the huts, gambling kind of is their religion, you know? They take gambling so seriously that, you know, I'll take this to the huts. Ooh. Okay, that's bad.
Yeah, I can imagine how that conversation goes. Well, did you make the bet?
Yeah.
Yeah, but, no, but.
Exactly.
There it is.
Yeah.
Very simplistic view.
Yeah, I know.
There's more of that. Very interesting way of being a mother.
Yeah. Yeah, there's something Shmi knows that, you know, she's always, you know, like we said, she's had this from his birth. She's always known there's something.
He's destined more for something.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sure you really think that about a child, that there was no father.
Yes, I mean, exactly. If there's anything to clue you in right off the get, that'd be it.
Yeah. It's not a normal occurrence.
No.
Stop the suns from setting up.
I almost would have liked to have seen a little more pushback from Anakin on this.
About leaving his mom?
Yeah. But I guess there's also, you know, he's figuring he'll be able to come back.
Yeah, I don't think he really understands what that commitment of being a Jedi is going to be.
Yeah, exactly.
There's his senses, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Because you know Qui-Gon felt it too, and mm-hmm. He's just being patient.
He felt it in both of them.
Yes.
But I thought that was a nice touch. You know, she kind of drops her head.
Yes.
And he pauses. Like, you could see that he sensed his mom's sadness.
Yes.
Yeah. So she obviously has an understanding of the Jedi. Yeah. At least to a degree.
Well, I mean, yeah, didn't Anakin?
I mean, he knew who they were.
Right, because he saw their laser sword, you know.
Right.
I'd imagine at this point, I'm sure there's a lot of people who never get to actually see Jedi, but they know of them.
And here we go.
Yeah.
Hmm. just looks awesome with that the heavy robes on, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Cloaked figure in heavy robes, comes out of nowhere.
And again, the calm of Obi-Wan. Oh, there's a lightsaber fight. You know, we haven't seen lightsaber on lightsaber fights since, ever, you know, for him. But he's just right. So calm, like, head that way.
And they still refer to him as the Jedi Arts.
Yes.
So it is interesting that Qui-Gon goes right to it was a Sith.
Yes.
That kind of gives the idea that you haven't dealt with too many force proficient adversaries.
Exactly.
I would assume, which is shocking to me, I would assume that you would deal with more people who inadvertently fall to the dark side. They're not Sith, because the Sith requires a certain amount of discipline and training. And
yeah, but maybe slightly nefarious.
Yes, I would assume Darksiders don't go away. Just organized, you know, dark side acolytes would be a very uncommon thing.
Yeah. Interesting. It's an interesting thought. Maybe they have encountered people like that.
Especially pretenders who would know the legends of the Sith and try to emulate them, idolize them.
Okay.
They're not Sith, but they...
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess if you're trying to emulate that, then that would actually launch you down the path of the Sith. It could.
Right. Now, while they're not a Sith proper, because, you know.
Rule of two.
Like I said, they. Huh?
Rule of two.
Rule of two. They would lack real structure on how to harness the dark side properly, because you kind of get the idea that without that proper training, the dark side would be even more wild.
Yeah.
You know, Palpatine even alludes to it. You need my guidance, you know?
Yeah. That scene always reminded me of the.
I can't believe he's gone.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
It's kind of the same thing, too, because, you know, Leia's planet just got blown up.
Yeah, uh-huh.
And he's like, oh, I can't believe Ben's gone. I mean, me and him have only been close for, like, the last 72 hours, but I can't believe he's gone.
Yeah.
And she just lost her entire...
Her planet's under siege. Yeah.
Yeah, and... Like Leia, her planet's, you know, Padme's planet's under siege.
Yes.
But, you know, Leia just lost her entire planet. Exactly. They're all dead.
Yes. This is one of those scenes where, you know, you get a really good look at Coruscant and it's like, wow.
Mm-hmm.
All that stuff. A lot of stuff to look at in the background. I love it.
Yeah. This kind of emphasizes that thing about the Naboo to the elegance of them. You can see why the Gungans wouldn't like them too much.
Yeah.
Everything is very, very over the top.
Oh, yeah. We see a lot of that on Coruscant here, though.
Yeah. But you expect that on Coruscant amongst the, you know, the corrupt Senate.
Yeah.
I guess that's a Gungan way of saying, yeah, I think she likes you. Yeah. Yeah, the, there we go. That's that corruption.
Yes. This is the part here where we're seeing Palpatine. You know, he's always playing an angle.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, you know, that's what I love about that character. He's always, I mean, he's always playing an angle. He's always working things to his advantage to get things to play out how he wants them, or to, when something doesn't play out how he wants it, he's going to use it to his advantage somehow, some way.
Yeah.
And ultimately, what we know now, it's a long, long game.
Yes. And he really... I like that look right there, too. He oh, kind of had that look like, oh, she's going right where I want her to go.
Exactly.
I thought this would be harder. Even that turn right there, he's like, what say you now? You're going to keep playing into my hand?
Here we have the Jedi Council. This was... very cool.
Oh, I do love that they replaced Yoda here.
Yeah.
That is the one thing. That puppet looks so bad in this setting.
Yeah. This is obviously the first time we saw Yoda on Dagobah.
Mm-hmm.
They used the lighting to their advantage, for sure. And this setting was just far too bright for that. So
yeah, it looked awful.
Yes.
It was the same puppy, yet it looked older.
Yeah.
Like here he's supposed to be younger, but yes. He looks older. Yeah, it worked on Dagobah.
Yeah.
Beautifully. On Dagobah, it even looked real. Like,
yeah.
In this scene, it looked like a crappy puppet.
Yeah. So they're talking about the prophecy here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And this is, you know, we're hearing about this prophecy and I'm wondering, do you think we're going to learn the origin of this prophecy maybe with what's coming down the pike for us in Star Wars? The High Republic stuff. Because that's something that I've always wanted to see them delve into a little bit is the, you know, where does the prophecy come from? Because it sets up Anakin's whole journey.
Right. Yeah, this was another clue. About Padme.
Oh.
Here she is. She's getting ready for the Senate. Obviously, yeah. They're not going to send a double to go to the Senate.
Exactly. Yes.
So she's prepping to go in there. Oh, I sent her on an errand.
Yeah.
Kind of makes you, like, wonder how bad are things on Naboo where you need to have a... a decoy. As far as like for the politicians, you know?
Yeah.
Again, I mean, they have like a lot of Julius Caesar's moments.
I don't know about that because, you know, she's a queen, but she's an elected queen, right?
Right.
But this is something that's been done. Again, this is merging the old with the new. Decoys, things like that, are something that have been done for centuries when it comes to royalty and such.
Yeah, worst job ever.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't like the politics and the stuff in the Senate hall. See, I think this is important.
Yeah, I agree. And I like this. And again, there he is manipulating. This is, you have the Trade Federation basically steamrolling over her.
I am not a committee. There it is. Oh, yeah, here we go.
Yes.
Yeah, that look. Oh, yeah. I win. Apparently, a lot of people were ready for that.
Yeah, and again, I think Palpatine's been planting a lot of those seeds.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Oh, I'm sure he's been doing a lot of the political whining and dining and gaining allies. And
again, from Plagueis, we kind of know that's been going on. Well, that's, again, legends now, I guess, but
that's why that book was so good.
I know. And again, we have this look of Coruscant.
It's just wild.
It is wild.
He's able to see things without seeing it. Like,
yeah.
Like, I couldn't.
So, man, if Yoda's that insightful right there, afraid to lose her, I think. You'd think he'd spend more time with Anakin saying, look, don't be so afraid of losing your mom.
Right. Well, here they're like, we're just not going to train him.
Oh, I know, but
what, you're once, right. He sees this in the beginning.
Yes.
Why wouldn't they pay special care to him once they agree?
Exactly.
Why wouldn't you keep working with him on letting go? And I understand there's a certain amount of things you have to do on your own.
Yeah.
But, yeah, why wouldn't they emphasize, oh, you gotta work on this.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I like this. A surprise.
Yeah.
Sure, buddy. And this is the beauty of Ian McDiarmid's performance throughout the saga. He really plays that duality well.
Oh, yes.
To go from one to the other, but still leave notes of the other, you know?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
He leaves a subtle deceitfulness in his performance.
Yes.
Very subtle.
And I love the, he's feigning concern. Yeah. What about the treaty?
Oh, no, wait, don't go. Don't stop. Go. Please, yeah. Don't.
Exactly. It's funny because she was forced to go to Coruscant, essentially. And then she was there long enough to do what he needed her to do. And off she goes. That's.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to do it anyway.
Yeah.
Okay, what you say. What?
I'm just thinking, you know, how does Obi-Wan feel right there? He's like, no, I'm ready. Really, I'm ready. But it's like, oh, you're going to just take him? Jeez.
Yeah. I'm sure he feels better after him saying that, but. You know, like saying like, oh, he's ready. He's ready.
Oh, yeah.
But like before that, he's like, I take him as my Padawan learner. Obi-Wan's like, what?
Wait, whoa, whoa.
Here I am, just regular old Obi-Wan, not the chosen one.
Exactly.
Obi-Wan is like, it's funny, while he... It's crazy to think he had such a master who was so willing to disobey the council.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's so by the book.
Yeah. I mean, the only real decision we see him make that goes against the council is to train Anakin.
Yeah.
But they kind of relent. So he's still not, he doesn't necessarily go against them because they relent.
True. Kid's like, I don't want to be a problem, but what are you going to do, kid? You're in this like different world. What would you do?
Yeah. You know, I like how he's like, I'm not allowed to train you, but hey, pay attention to what I do.
Yeah.
You're going to do that stuff, okay?
Yeah.
But don't call it training.
Exactly.
He is very, yeah, I'm going to do what I want.
So we get our little exposition on midichlorians. Kind of.
That's a hot button topic, too. Like, how do you feel about midichlorians? Like,
me? I'm okay with it. But I'm okay with it, but I don't like how do you put it? I don't want them to necessarily be in control of your use of the force kind of thing.
Right.
You know, I want you to have free will, you know, as a person, midichlorians are, I look at them as some sort of like a microbiome type thing. You know, without them, you couldn't have force abilities, but they also don't necessarily control your use of the force. So,
right. I mean, do you like it better than the idea of it just being like magic?
I guess. The idea of magic, you know, all throughout the ages, you know, anything you don't understand can look like magic. So,
right. I guess my only issue, like, I don't really have an issue with midichlorians, but I guess my only issue with that is it's always been a thing in the Star Wars going, hey, science doesn't
true
play a role here, but here's this in-universe science that we're going to use to explain this.
Well, it's in-universe.
I understand that. But they try to explain it in a way that makes sense in our universe, you know? Like,
kinda, yeah. I see what you're saying.
So, don't say, oh, well, you can't talk about gravity. It's Star Wars. I mean, it's fantasy.
Right.
But then here's all this science as to how this works.
Well, you know, repulsor lifts make speeders float. It's
yeah, like I said, I don't have a problem with it.
Right.
You know, that's one thing I always wanted to see.
The trials?
The trials.
Yeah.
Like, maybe with the, you know, the Disney Plus series that are going to be coming at us left and right, maybe there will be one that kind of explores that.
That'd be cool.
I think that would be cool.
It's a sacred place. Hey, follow me. I'll show you.
It's a sacred place. It's right over here.
Yeah, exactly.
Let me take you humans. I mean, it's already banished, so.
Yeah, true.
What are they going to do?
Again, though, you get this impression this is ancient.
Yeah.
This spot. And this is also, you know, the Padme thing, the double, where it comes out and
okay, bomb bad can mean bad stuff too.
Yeah, yeah. What? It's like, by this point, we all knew. And that look on Qui-Gon's face and Obi-Wan, it's funny. It's like, yeah.
Qui-Gon's like, oh, I never thought she'd stop lying. I've been lying this whole time, but
yeah, but it's like, if only she spoke that well in the Senate, that's, you know what I mean? This could have all been avoided.
You think so?
I don't know, but I mean, she just did that right there with confidence. And in the Senate, there was no confidence displayed. But I think that was also partially the control of
Palpatine,
yeah. Not control necessarily, but influence.
I think she started planning this out though when Jar Jar said, we have a grand army.
Yeah.
She's like, oh, we don't have an army. They have an army.
True.
It's like, okay, we got to be friends.
Yep. Common enemy.
Yeah, it's a good thing they found the army, because you see what they have, like, security force wise. It's like,
yeah,
you're not fighting a big droid army with this.
Exactly.
Yeah, get the little bit of distraction going.
Exactly. Classic nab Star Wars.
Nab the people in charge.
Yep.
I couldn't stand the Naboo before, and now I was like, ah, we're ready to die for you.
Yeah.
He'll return with another droid army. Like, the Jedi know this, but they're not super involved yet.
Right.
Like, they... they send the two Jedi to be, like, ambassadors.
Yeah.
But they know that, like, oh, there's a droid army, and then there's another droid army. I guess they can't just make a decision to get involved without the Senate being behind it. But
true. That's where the Jedi have kind of gotten bogged down. Their involvement with the Senate and the Chancellor, whoever that may be.
That's a lot of Gungans.
Yes, it is.
Very, very, crude weapons and stuff, but they got a shield.
Yeah. This is also nice. It's like a callback to old days of war where, you line yourselves up on the open battlefield.
Yep. Yeah, very ancient warfare.
Like, yes.
Like granted the early days of firearm warfare were still very similar, kind of had that same old mindset.
Yes.
Like, the proper way to fight is to line up and be fair,
Yeah.
There was always like a gentleman's agreement kind of thing in warfare. This was the way it was done. This was...
exactly.
I mean, you had strategies and stuff like flanking and things like that, but you didn't hide in the trees and shoot projectiles, you know?
Right.
What?
No, I'm just, this is the part where it's like, you know, whole climax of everything. I'm loving it.
Yeah.
The first good look at these fighters. It's like, wow, that's a pretty cool design.
But it's more about the Naboo there, though. Like, even their fighters have to look,
yes,
you know, fancy and elegant.
Yep.
You know, something like an X-Wing would not be good for the Naboo.
Right. Because
it just looks like crap.
Again, there's, you know, the pilots of these ships, they're wearing these like leather caps and goggles as opposed to, you know, the helmets you wear in an X-Wing or a Y-Wing or something. It's like a blending of old and new. Kind of cool.
Yeah, that's his World War One, World War Two.
Yeah.
You know, leather cap and goggles.
I love how Jar Jar is kind of like in charge now. Steady.
Steady.
It's like, what? No one's listening to you.
Give it time. Give it time. He'll be freaking out in a second.
Oh, yeah.
Right? I always wondered what these big beach balls were, man.
Yeah. Balls of energy of some sort.
Yeah. Well, I guess it would probably be plasma, right? That was the big thing on Naboo.
I guess, plasma. Yeah. That's a lot of droids.
Yes. Ouch time. He knows this is not going to go well.
Yeah.
Yeah, those. Yeah, those blue balls of energy, they're wacky to me.
They are wacky. Sure, sure.
Yeah, I like their shields though. Those.
Oh yeah.
Energy shields, handheld.
You knew right then he's going to be flying that ship.
Oh, yeah.
Ah, here we go.
Some of John Williams' finest here, too.
Yes.
I mean, The two in the prequels that really stand out to me is Duel of the Fates.
Yep.
And Battle of Heroes.
Yes.
And there's a lot of kind of Duel of the Fates callbacks in Battle of Heroes.
Oh, yeah. The double-sided lightsaber. Oh,
yep.
Man.
Yeah, you knew there, too, that, like, Obi-Wan, Qui-Gon.
Yeah.
He's definitely not, like, fit to be a father.
Stay in that cockpit?
Yes, yeah, you'll be safe there.
Yeah.
A kid.
Right.
In a starship fighter. Yeah, what could go wrong? I mean, I'm 35 years old. I wouldn't be able to sit in there without pushing a button.
Exactly. Just, I'm the same way.
Yeah, like was it Randy Quaid, right?
Oh yeah.
In Independence Day?
Heck yeah.
Oh crap.
Missile armed. Ah!
Yep, that'd be me.
Yeah.
Cause I'd have to. What's this button do?
Exactly. So already we've been treated with some of the best lightsaber dueling action we've seen ever in Star Wars.
Yeah. Oh, ever. I mean, there's been nothing like this.
Right.
It's always been very straight up kind of broadsword fight. Like,
yes, that's a good way of putting it. I like that, broadsword fighting. Yep.
Yep.
Whereas this is, you know, far more agile, higher speed.
Wait a minute, martial arts to it, you know?
Yes.
And, you know, it was obviously very intentional just with the casting. You knew that that's what George wanted.
Yes.
You bring in someone like Ray Park. Dumb droid.
Charger. Ooh, I can use this.
Yeah.
Silly, but it's like, why doesn't he just pick up the blaster?
Yeah, I think this is probably the most going on at once. And
this is very reminiscent of
Return of the Jedi. Yes,
Return of the Jedi for me. So many different things happening, and it's intentional that way.
You got a space battle, you got a ground battle, you've got, you know, a lightsaber battle.
Yep. Now this one, it's definitely got more. You have four things, right? You have a ground battle, a space battle, an infiltration, and a lightsaber battle. That's, that's a good trick. Again.
Even R2's like, dude. For real?
Yes.
I guess we know why R2 ends up as crazy as he does later on. Like he's, right. He's with Anakin, and Anakin's like, no, look, I get it.
From the time he's a little kid, he's like, hey, whatever. Let's just do it.
R2 just becomes numb to that stuff. Like,
yeah.
These blasters they've got here are just like the Swiss Army knife of blasters.
Heck yeah.
Ouch.
Yeah.
Yeah, the speed of this fight was so astonishing.
Yes. It was like nothing we ever saw before, for sure.
Like even a moment like this where they're kind of fighting in that same style, right? That we've seen already.
Yep.
It's very straightforward, not too acrobatic. But the pace of that is just, it's the pace of when Luke lost it, you know?
Yes.
But it's that pace all the time.
The whole way, exactly.
At the same time, this fight is different in the other from the others, and there is no banter here.
True. True.
You know, Luke and Vader were always bantering back and forth. There was always a conversation being had during the fight.
Yes.
Here, there's no time for a talk.
No.
Maul's there for one reason. He's not there to turn nobody. He's there to eliminate.
Yes, for sure.
It's So a different tone to the battle as well, because there is no compromise here.
Right.
You can't talk your way out of it.
Right. Charger.
They went to Walmart for that soundbite.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know those bouncy balls that are always in the big, like,
oh, right, you know, right.
Rope. Yeah, that's what those sound like. Dung, 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 dung.
Juggle, juggle, juggle. And, of course, in it goes.
Success.
Yes.
I mean, I understand, you know, some of people's complaints. Like, they do go over the top with Jar Jar, for sure.
Oh, yeah.
And it is a little much at times.
Yes.
But at the same time, you know, they had to do something to keep the tone.
A little lightness in
a
the
A little
tone.
Light, because yeah, it's yeah. Star Wars.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, you don't want it to be all death all the time, because that's what it would be right there. The Gungans would just be getting slaughtered.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Anakin does a pretty good job of it, though, too, here.
Oh, adding the comedy?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. No, it's not good.
I like this dichotomy of at peace,
calm,
and then anger.
Yeah, he's just chomping at the bit to get back to fighting.
Yes.
Whereas Qui-Gon's composing himself.
Right.
At the same time, he probably feels what's coming.
Oh, yeah. You can feel it in the tone of this battle. It's...
Well, yeah, and right there, the music was gone.
Yes.
During that portion, and then now it's back.
Yes.
You had no music, nothing to, like, hint to you what's coming. And in a way, it hinted at it anyway.
Yes. Because something they've always been good at is where there needs to be no music, they know when to eliminate it in the editing.
Well, yeah, because and Star Wars is almost wall-to-wall music all the time.
Yeah.
And there are select scenes that just, there's no music.
Right.
Like, even here, you know, you had music swelling.
I love that. This one's a decoy. It worked.
Went wrong.
And she knows where she's got the weapon stash. It's
I mean, that didn't even look like it wasn't a secret compartment. You know, like, it looked like a secret compartment.
Yeah.
Bad guys never learn, man. Clear out the secret compartments.
Exactly.
You don't need that stuff there. That's only going to work against you when they come in there. Now here we see some Obi-Wan anger.
Oh, yes.
And if this fight wasn't already at a fever pitch.
Oh, I know. This is what. Oh.
Pretty sure this is where Rey got his black eye.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. If you look in the, like, behind the scenes stuff, there's parts where they got their sticks and they're fighting.
Yep.
Rey has an absolute shiner. Which, I mean, hey, good for you, and you got a shot in on Ray Park.
Yeah, I know.
You don't need that. That's one thing about the prequels here. Like, lightsabers just get lost all the time.
That's true. It seems to happen a lot. Oh.
Oops, he says.
Oops. Just so happens to like take out the core.
You're like winning the battle right now, dude. Yeah. Like,
it kind of cracks me up that, you know, no one else thought of this, of trying this too.
It's like, right,
we all know how these things are, how hard
they're constructed. Not exactly seasoned veterans though either.
That's true.
They got these fighters to be like a deterrent. Never thought they'd be using them in battle.
You're right, like a local defense almost. Yeah. Now, that one central station was, there was droid 1138.
See? Yep.
It was controlling all these droids, but there were all kinds of stations up there. So they couldn't just transfer control from one to the other?
Apparently not. Mistakes were made.
Yes, exactly.
I'm sure they were sure to rectify that in the future.
Yeah.
But this is...
So, I gotta say, with that move, I love that move. But leading up to it, Obi-Wan was almost telegraphing to Maul what he was going to do.
Yeah, he's like, okay, I see that lightsaber over there.
Yep. So. All right.
And I find it surprising that, like, with Obi-Wan's, like, respect for the high ground.
Yes. Yes. That's right.
Like, he's, like, telling Anakin, like, that move will never work.
Never work. He's like, no, work for me. That's funny.
Maybe it's because, like, look, I invented this move. You're not getting me with this one.
Yes.
Like, that's my move, dude.
Yeah. Well, okay. To be fair, Maul watched him flip right over the top of him. Obi-Wan did not watch Anakin flip over the... He was swinging, so...
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, maybe, right?
Yeah, this is...
Yeah. Yeah, I bet you will, buddy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I mean, that was his goal all along, right?
Of course.
Think about the bad guys. They don't know they're the bad guy.
That's right. That's right.
Ooh. So he says the council.
Right.
You know, and then I.
Do not. Yeah.
Hmm. But this is the only time you see that defiance, you know? Like,
yes.
This is pretty much the end of it.
Yeah.
You know, Obi-Wan turns into the perfect Jedi,
yeah,
if you would. You know,
towing the company like, line.
The rules.
So it's funny how, you know, Qui-Gon's body doesn't vanish. Yet, he's the one who teaches Yoda and Obi-Wan how to commune with Jedi in the Force.
Yeah, but I think I almost get the impression that he figured that out from beyond.
It could be. We know he had an alternate way of looking at things in the Force, that's for sure.
Yeah, the and if you didn't know who Palpatine was here before this, you do now.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
All right, so this sequence here. You listen to David Collins' show, right? The soundtrack show?
Sure.
So he talked about this track.
Uh-huh.
This is absolutely masterful on John Williams' part. Because this celebration music is literally the Emperor's theme.
Oh, yes.
In a major key.
Yes, yes. Yes, that's right.
You are celebrating with the bad guy's jam.
Yep.
It's like, celebrate for now, but it ain't gonna last.
Exactly.
Then they get a plasma ball.
Yeah.
Who can walk by one of those without, you know, touching it?
Exactly.
You can't. Yeah, so I love this film. I really do.
Absolutely.
It's like I said, one, it's my first theatrical Star Wars experience, so it's got that place in my heart.
Yes. Not for me, but I will say this was there was a time when I thought there was only going to be three films. Then we learned of this one, and leaving the theater after seeing this one, it was like, you know, you just got done seeing this, which was awesome, and you had the anticipation of two more, and I don't know, I was grinning ear to ear. It's
yeah, I mean, it's new and exciting times. You know, for the old guard of Star Wars.
Exactly, right? Like, for sure.
And for those like me who, yes, I was a Star Wars fan going in because I got treated to the original trilogy by my parents, right?
Yep.
And I loved them. I think seeing Star Wars in the theater for the first time kind of jump-started my fandom.
Oh, yeah.
Into being what it is today.
I bet.
The prequels are totally responsible for that.
Yeah.
While I was a huge Star Wars fan as a younger kid, I was a huge Star Wars fan because that's what I liked. You know, it was like,
yeah,
people being a huge Transformers fan or a huge, you know, it wasn't the level as it is today.
Right. I gotcha.
You know, at that time I didn't think about, hey, someday I'm going to do a Star Wars show, you know?
Exactly.
But the prequels were the moment where I knew that this fandom was going to be with me for a long time, well into my adult years.
Heck yeah.
So yeah, I couldn't wait for the second installment when I walked out of the theaters.
Oh yeah.
You know, in 99 there.
So there was something I, you know, none of us, but we had no idea like at what point it was going to pick up or anything. You know, Anakin's just a kid, you know. All we knew is that little kid has to wind up being Darth Vader. So it was like, how are they going to make this happen? That's what was so intriguing about it. It was
right. Yeah. Here you got this beautiful innocence.
Yes.
But he's got to be the most feared guy in the galaxy.
Exactly.
Because Vader was the one up front. Palpatine was in the back.
Right.
Vader was the face of the might of the Empire.
Yeah.
So.
Totally.
You know, yeah, it's... It was a tall task to set before himself with that.
Like, yeah, for sure.
Because there's not an ounce of bad in Anakin Skywalker in this film.
Right.
Not 1 ounce. And I think that threw a lot of people in the beginning because, like, you expect to see at least a little glimpse into why he would go that way right from the get-go.
Yeah, like I said, you know, the little kid pulling legs off crickets or something. It's you know, we got none of that. And you have to wonder, you know, how does this kid become Vader? So, in a sense, you left the theater with a lot of anticipation, but no way of knowing where the story was going to go, what direction. So, I like that. I like that a lot because everything moving forward was still a complete mystery.
Yeah. All right. So I think that pretty much wraps up episode one. Any final thoughts you have before we, you know, wrap this up completely? Anything you wanted to make note of?
No, I think I pretty much put it out there, you know, what, you know, my thoughts at the moment, but, I guess I do want to say I, seeing this as an adult, I never had any animosity towards any characters or the storyline or the politics or any of it. I just went there, watched the movie and took it all in for what it was. And you know, it was Star Wars as far as I was concerned, you know?
Yeah.
And that's how it was for me.
And that's how you should, you know, take it. That's,
exactly.
I mean, you're not going in there. You didn't watch Star Wars as a young kid, right? Looking for this thing or that thing that it had to have or
right.
Anything like that. You went in there to see a fantasy story and just ended up falling in love.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, you didn't go in there saying, you know, oh, it better have this or I'm going to be pissed.
Exactly.
So, and I didn't go in there for this film like that at all, mostly because, you know, I was just excited to see Star Wars in the theater for the first time.
Yeah.
You know, I love Star Wars, you know, throughout my childhood, and here I get to see it on the big screen for the first time. The way everybody tells me this is the way to see Star Wars.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
You know, that was the sentiment even back then.
Yeah.
Like, this is the way to see Star Wars. And they weren't wrong. Even the films that I, you know, like, you know, the least, I still enjoyed watching them in the theaters.
Absolutely.
It's just a franchise that plays really well in the theaters.
For sure.
All right. Well, I will go out the typical way that we go out. If you have anything to add to any of that, anything you'd like to see in the future, you can always email us. show@thewarsandmore.com. It's the best way to get a hold of us. But we're also on social media. We're at The Wars and More on Twitter, facebook.com/thewarsandmore. You find all that and all the ways to find the show over at thewarsandmore.com. I already asked for final thoughts, so yeah, we'll talk next time, man.